Good afternoon. We're just waiting for a few folks to jump on before we get started. But welcome again to Charleston, South Carolina. Andrew with Bulldog Tours coming at you again. Like I said, we're going to give it just a few minutes, allow for anybody else who wants to jump on to the video today to do that, and then we're going to get started. We are down here on Lower Church Street in the historic district. Very quiet out here. Not a lot of people out walking around or anything like that. So pretty secluded. But one thing that I also wanted to do before we really kind of jumped into today's lesson is that I've been doing a few of these now. And I wanted just to give you a little bit more about me. Of course, my name is Andrew Kuhn. I am a tour guide, of course, with Bulldog Tours. I am born and raised right here in Charleston. Hey, Clara, how are you? I have been a tour guide going on for about 7 years now. I absolutely love Charleston, love everything about the city, cannot learn enough about it. And so in addition to that, one thing I also love doing is in my free time, I love drawing and painting, and that actually gave me some inspiration for today's video. And it's about one of the most famous artists that has come out of Charleston. And in addition to that, one question that we often get on our tours is, man, y'all have got like a lot of art galleries all over the city. And the answer is absolutely we do. And I'm going to talk a little bit about why that is. Oh, Mama's watching. Hi, Mama. So to kind of give a little introduction to what we're going to talk about, again, into a period of Charleston called the Charleston Renaissance. But the first kind of look at Charleston from an artistic standpoint actually occurred right at the turn of the 20th century. A few years earlier in 1893, Chicago held its very famous World's Fair. And if you're not familiar, of course, the World's Fair is something that still happens every couple of years, even today, but it's basically it's a big festival, a big fair for people to come out from all over the world to show off and highlight new modern forms of technology. It would show off architecture and art, and really was just and they used to be, you know, something of the day. And the one in Chicago in 1893 was to also highlight the 400th anniversary of Christopher Columbus's journey to the New World. And so I'm sure a lot of you out there have probably heard of the Chicago World's Fair, but Charleston at that time was still in a lot of economic poverty from the Civil War. That was 30, 40 years earlier. And so they saw what happened with Chicago and they said, wow, that'd be really great if we could do that here in Charleston. And so they started a fair of their own. And what they called it was the South Carolina Interstate and West Indian Exposition, and try saying that five times fast. Like I said, a lot of you probably out there have heard of the Chicago World's Fair, but I'd be willing to bet that not many of you have ever heard of the South Carolina Interstate and West Indian Exposition. And the reason why is because the South Carolina Interstate and West Indian Exposition failed miserably. It did not have the great success that the one in Chicago did. And a lot of things just going against it. For example, Teddy Roosevelt was slated to attend, and he did, but he ended up not coming right until the end of the fair. A very famous author by the name of Samuel Clemens, also known as Mark Twain, came to that fair. He actually sent a letter back to his wife and said there was no one there. It just never really got attention. One of the other things, it started on December 1st of 1901, which was a Sunday. And in a city called the Holy City, a lot of people were not going to the fair. They were going to church. So again, just a lot of things going against it, but it was separated into two sections. One was all about art, and the other one was all about nature. And so 20 different states represented. The state of Pennsylvania actually brought the Liberty Bell down to Charleston, showed it off. There was a building dedicated to African-American history that was led by Booker T. Washington. So a lot of big names and a lot of great things kind of saw that, but you know, it failed. 675,000 people came to that fair in the course of 6 months. The one in Chicago brought in 27 million. So essentially, it didn't boost the economy like Charleston was hoping, but what it did was it started to look at Charleston from an artistic standpoint. And so with that, I'm going to turn my camera around. We're going to start walking. And If y'all have any questions, by all means, guys, please ask away. I probably won't necessarily address them as we're walking and talking, but we're actually going to stop up here and sit down to, I brought some props for today. But of course, the South Carolina Interstate and West Indian Exposition was actually held up at where the Citadel in Hampton Park is today, which Gordon did a great job a couple weeks ago talking about. But really kind of the first big boom into our economy came in World War One with the establishment of the Naval Yard. And of course, Lisa, last couple of days, has been doing a great job talking about the history of the Naval Yard in Charleston. But from that time period of World War One up until World War Two, you essentially had what was called a period of the Charleston Renaissance. And it focused both on not only art, but also in writing. And a lot of famous painters came from the Charleston Renaissance. One was a man by the name of Alfred Huddy. And Alfred Huddy actually originated from New York. And after serving in World War One, he came to Charleston. And he immediately wired back to his wife and he said, "Come quickly, have found heaven." And it's one of the most famous quotations about Charleston that still gets quoted on tours today. Other people, Alice Ravenel Eugene Smith was a famous artist, Edwin Harleston, list goes on and on. But my personal favorite and a favorite of many here in Charleston is a woman by the name of Elizabeth O'Neill Verner. And right now we're on the corner of Church and Trad Street. So I'll show you Trad Street, which is argued to be the oldest street in Charleston. But right here on the corner was actually the studio of Elizabeth O'Neill Verner. And so safely cross over the street here. I'll go and show you her actual name and on the building. Now it's a private residence today. So even though you're gonna see it says museum, that is not accurate. But you can see here the studio and museum of Elizabeth O'Neill Verner. Now, of course, talking about art and this woman, the props I brought is actually to show you some of the paintings that and works that she did. So we're going to walk up the street here and show you some of that. But while we walk up Church Street, tell you a little bit more about her. She was actually a second generation Charlestonian. She grew up on Legree Street, which is just a few blocks west of where we're standing. And her grandfather hailed from Ireland, very big Catholic family, and they moved down to Charleston, or they moved to Charleston, and then again, Elizabeth O'Neill Verner was born in 1883. She was the second of nine children that survived to adulthood. There was actually 12 kids, but only nine made it to adulthood. And Elizabeth Verner, as she grew up in Charleston, the one thing that she always wanted to be a part of was the kind of Charleston social elite. That was something that kind of drove her for all of her life. The problem was that she didn't have the name. She was a second generation, and a lot of people even today make the jokes about how you have to be at least four generations to be considered an actual Charlestonian. And so she kind of fought that for a long time. But in addition to that, the kind of other side of it was that she also wanted to depict Charleston as accurately as possible, which from the aesthetics, the beauty, and of course, the African-American presence. And so she would incorporate a lot of that into her art, which would kind of separate her from that elite in a lot of ways, especially in the 1920s and 30s. And so Verner was actually introduced to the medium of etchings. And Alice Ravenel Eugene Smith was the person who kind of taught her into that trade. And for a lot of her earlier life, Verner was an artist as more of a hobby. She didn't really do it as a profession, but at the age of 20, in 1925, at the age of 42, she became divorced, she became widowed, and she had two kids and she had to raise them. And so basically she was encouraged to become an artist as a way of life. And so that's what she ended up doing. And so she combined, she said, her two favorite hobbies, which were art and the love of history. And so I brought this book, but I'm going to sit down to make it easier if y'all show y'all. But where we're going to sit down is actually right here, what's called a Charleston joggling board. These are all over Charleston. And a joggling board, there's a lot of arguments over how these things got started and what they were used for. A lot of people will make the argument they were used for exercise because it kind of had the same motion of when you kind of sit on it and it rocks, kind of like riding a carriage. Some people believe that led to weight loss, which meant that all you had to do was sit on this, bounce up and down, and you would lose weight. And my God, if it were that easy, that would be wonderful, but it's not. And so they eventually became known as kind of courting boards, because what would happen is that by design, you would have two people interested in each other sit on opposite ends, and as you bounced, you would get closer and closer and closer. So I thought, how appropriate then to sit down and show y'all some art on a Charleston joggling board. And so to begin with, I'm trying to make this thing go all over the place. A couple days ago, y'all saw Braxton. And Braxton did Philadelphia Alley. And so this is a Werner work of Philadelphia Alley. And if anyone's not familiar with the etching process, basically what she would have done is that Werner would have taken a copper plate. She would have taken a tool and etched in that design that you're seeing right here. At which point she covered it in acid, and the acid would burn away everything that she did not touch. And then what she would do is it turned it basically into a giant stamp. And then she would dip it in ink and then press it onto the paper. So of course it had to do it in reverse, which was very, very difficult. And then from that you can make prints out of this. And so this book that I'm showing you is actually a very old book of some of her most famous etchings. It was one of 1,500 signed copies, and that's her signature right there. But prints and impressions of Charleston, Elizabeth O'Neill Werner. But the one that I really wanted to show off to y'all is this one right here, which is called Under the Shadow of St. Michael's. And this was one of her etchings that truly defined who she was, because when you notice, you have the African-American woman who is carrying the flowers and fruits in the basket above her head, but it says under the shadow of St. Michael's. When you consider that St. Michael's was essentially built by the planter elite, that the people that she wanted to be in with in that social circle all came from one of the biggest congregations, which would have been St. Michael's. It's that she is both literally and figuratively placed in the shadow of the culture that created it, in that sense of irony. And so that's what you have here with Under the Shadow of St. Michael's. Another one real quick, which is another classic view of Charleston, is actually not far from where we are, which is Church Street. And you actually have on the left-hand side, the Dock Street Theater. On the right, you have the French Huguenot Church. And then of course, down in the distance, you have St. Philip's, which is the oldest congregation here in the city of Charleston. And so just some beautiful artwork by Werner herself. Now, you know, the thing about Werner, like I said, was this challenge of being part of the social circle. And one thing that I think that she identified very early, and it still remains true in a lot of ways, is that, you know, coming down to a place like Charleston, money is always a great thing to have, but money comes and goes. The way that Charleston has always considered itself, you know, among the elite, was always by their names. It's how many generations you were, where you came from, and so forth. And as people started to visit Charleston in the 1920s and 30s, for the first time on a mass scale, they were looking at this artwork and they wanted to see it through the eyes of that old Charleston. And Werner was somebody who challenged mind she wasn't, even though she was born and raised here. And so what she would do is that she would actually mass produce a lot of her images, put it on a postcard scale, and then she would sell it in local museums and galleries and all over the city of Charleston. And it was a way for a lot of visitors to take a little piece of Charleston back home with them. To be honest with you, when you look at a Werner painting, for anybody who's a historian, a visitor, you can look at her work and it does, in a very real sense, transport you back into that time, back onto those city streets. But I will say this, for anybody who is from Charleston, for anyone who lives here, she is the artist who we all look at. And it not only is a visual representation of our past, it is a visual definition of who we are. As Werner once commented, that she said, the mission of an artist is to teach the untrained eye to look at something that it has always seen. And that looking is an act of will. And so as the act of will, being that when she specifically designed the images and the portrayals of our city, is that she wanted to get that aesthetic and that beauty in there just right, but she complemented it with the preservation movement that was just getting started, with race and with everything at that time to be as accurate as possible. She is without a doubt my favorite, my mama's favorite who's watching. Our boss, John Laverne, she is his favorite as well. And you'll find that across the city. If you ever come across an Elizabeth O'Neill Werner painting or illustration, of course, it is something that's very valued here in our city today. So real quickly, I'll take a look through and see if anyone has any comments or any questions. I'm going to kind of move away a little bit from the construction that's going on across the street. But Diane, how are you doing? Dad's on here as well. Hey, Dad. Hi from Cane Bay. Love these tours. From Mary. Thank you, Mary. We appreciate it. Hayward, Wisconsin. I don't know where Hayward is, but one of my best friends is from Phillips, Wisconsin. So I don't know if that's close to y'all or not. Hey, Paulette, how are you? Columbus, Sherry from Columbus, welcome. And we got Tad and Zach on. Welcome, guys. Alan, Diane. Watching for any of these tours have been great entertainment. Thank you so much for doing these for us. Absolutely. We love doing them. Love bringing Charleston to y'all. Karen, hello from Matthews, Virginia. Well, welcome. And then John, of course, watching from John's Island. Blue Ridge Tours, watching from Monroe, Washington. Yep, that's Paulette. Miss you, Paulette. Wish you, love to have you, love to see y'all again. Bluegrass State says hello. Hello to the Bluegrass State. You and Andrew Reed might enjoy these. Great history of the city. Stuart's watching. Hey, Stu, how are you? Beautiful day in Charleston. Let's see here. So, I love her art. Sherry says, I love her art. I have 11 old postcards of her work. They say copyright by Elizabeth O'Neill Werner for postcard use only. I guess they're the real deal. Thanks for this. Absolutely. In fact, she actually wrote... She wrote a few things, but one of her most famous is a book called Mellow by Time. I am lucky to have an autographed copy of that book. But if you're interested in some of her actual writing and how she kind of interpreted a lot of her work, it's called Mellow by Time. Thanks for doing this. John's the best dressed man in Charleston. That he is, especially in the America getup. Many tours with us. Really appreciate it. Looking forward to visiting soon. Well, that's it, guys. Thank y'all so much. Can I email you a Werner print? I have to ID location. Yes, Kathleen, when I get off of here, I will send you my email and you can absolutely send me anything by Werner. I'll be happy to take a look at it. With that, guys, I will tell you that tomorrow I'm actually coming at you again because I'm a big fan of the Charleston Renaissance. I am a big fan of the art scene in Charleston, especially from the years past. One of the more, I would say, more recent artists, if you wanted to get into, look at some other work, is a man by the name of John Carroll Doyle. A little bit more recent than Werner, but he's another one of my favorites. But the other big component of the Charleston Renaissance wasn't just the art. Of course, it was from the writing perspective. And so that's what we're going to talk about tomorrow. So I am literally going to pick it up right where I'm standing, right where we are right now. And we're going to talk about some of the authors and writers that come from this period as well. So thank you guys for joining in with us. Any questions, again, I'll be on here looking at them later and be happy to answer them. But stay safe out there. We're going to keep coming at you as long as needed. So thanks again, guys, and God bless.